Hey guys, Michael Antonovich with this episode of the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha. Joining me for this one is Monster Yamaha Star Racing's Justin Cooper. Thanks for stopping by today. Fresh off the final pro motocross race of the year. You stopped by the office. How was the summer? How was the year?
Yeah, it was a tough one. It was one of the most adverse, I guess, championships I've had to go through. It's been really up and down year for me, and just a lot had to get sorted out in kind of a short period of time, and it was tough coming off the couch and, you know, watching all the Supercross racing and then, you know, showing up to Paula round one, like kind of wondering where I'm at, like all the jitters, all the, you know, getting the rustiness out. So as far as that goes, that it was hard to get into the series, and then, you know, once the series got going, there was still a lot to go and you know, relearn and figure out. So it was quite the challenge, but overall, looking back on it, it was a good year.
I have to tell you, I'm very impressed with just how much better you got, how quickly you got. I saw you at the Daytona Supercross and like the credential line, and you'd gotten out of the back seat of the car and you were still on the scooter, and I was like, whoa. We were not that far away from the first outdoor race of the year, and you still couldn't even really bear weight on your ankle. And then you jumped up and were going again pretty soon after that. And those first few races of the year, as you worked through the issues, it kept coming around. So I think that was huge. At that point in the season and that point in the year, like, how was your mental state? Were you like, man, we're going to make it, or was it questionable then?
Yeah, I think we knew we were going to make it. But yeah, back at Daytona, I think I had just gotten all the hardware out, and I wasn't feeling good. I mean, it was like not panic time, but like, hey, I got to get going. Like, this is kind of like ending the Supercross season. Like, we're a few weeks out, and yeah, we got to start, you know, getting on the bike and, you know, training to be ready for this. And yeah, we went to round one, and it was kind of a wake up call. I went like 11:13, and I was like, ooh, I didn't think it was going to go that bad. But I was struggling that day with, you know, bike setup and stuff like that. But still, it was like, well, am I an 11th place guy, or am I, you know, a podium guy still? So luckily, I got on the podium the next weekend, and that kind of like, you know, calmed me down a little bit. But it was a long week with, you know, a lot of thinking after that first round for sure.
Was this the longest you've ever been off the motorcycle? Like, we've talked about in the past how, you know, living in the Northeast, you guys would have those times off, but this has got to be the longest reason why you haven't been able to. Something that you can't train, you can't do a lot of stuff. So how was it when you finally got to get back on the bike and go into the routine of things?
Yeah, I think the longest I was off the bike before this was like 7 weeks from an injury, and this ended up being something like 3.5-4 months. So it was definitely... it was tough mentally to prepare for that, and especially when I couldn't really do anything but like scooter around my house and sit on the couch. That was like a little bit different than, you know, having like an arm where you can like walk around and you're still doing stuff. But yeah, I was pretty much in the house for, I remember sitting in the house for like weeks straight, like didn't really want to go anywhere, and like everything was just pretty bad. So I had to clean my foot every night. That was really tough, because like it was just like not something I wanted to look at every day. Like, it was all taped up and, you know, bandaged up, and I had to rewrap it every night. So that was definitely one of the hard parts of it. You know, I didn't want to look at it. I knew it was bad to begin with, but to look at it every day and, you know, have to go through that whole situation was tough. So it was a tough couple months, but yeah, it was able to, once I got back on the bike, things started to click, and, you know, my foot consistently got better and still is getting better. It's a long injury, so yeah, here we are at the end of a season now.
Just to be on that scooter for that long seems like it would just be so draining, you know, because I know a bunch of people have had to use them, and I've like kicked around on it before, but I could only imagine 12 weeks on that thing.
Yeah,
you know, plus hardware sticking out and everything. That dude, just yikes.
If it wasn't for cleaning the hardware, like, it was just like seeing it every day, reminding me, like, it was nice to just go, like, I remember there was a few days I didn't have to clean it, and it was like so nice, like, I didn't have to deal with it. So going around on a scooter was actually nice in the house. Like, I didn't have to crutch around or anything like that, but yeah, it got old quick. I really wanted to walk and I couldn't. It was like non-weight bearing for like 3 months, so it was, yeah, it's just something like that. You're like, all right, I just got to push through this, and, you know, it'll be better soon. It was, it was honestly pretty miserable. So, yeah, by far one of the worst injuries I've had.
You know, we hear guys go through these periods of time and they think about all the stuff that goes on and they use it as like a reflection time. So what did you guys think about during that point? Was that more to get you fired up for the summer that you had and the next stage of your career, or were you more focused on just getting healed up at that time?
I mean, at the time, I really didn't have anything to focus on but healing. Like, I was watching the races, but it was so far from like where I was at, like, to even like I couldn't even, like, imagine like myself out there, because it was like totally not like the situation I was even close to being in as far as being on a bike. So it was mainly focusing on just healing and, you know, getting through it day by day. And, you know, it was like getting through each week before my doctor's visit. That was kind of what I was looking at, the timeline there and how long it was going to be until I got the hardware out of my foot, because that's really what I wanted. It was a lot to deal with when it was in. So once I got that out, it was much better. Like, I was kind of stressing about that, and everything ended up coming out. It was a really good surgery, so the best it could have been, I guess. And yeah, once everything came out, it was kind of like a lot easier, because I didn't have to clean it much, and just had to take care of it that first week or so while the wounds closed. And then I started like swimming and all that. And, you know, once that point got there, I had like a month until I started riding, and I could kind of just get back to normal life a little bit. Like, I had a boot on and I was walking, and I could, I could just get around normally and felt like a normal human being again. So once that was the case, then it was kind of like, all right, what's the next step? What do I need to do to be the best I can when I do get back on a dirt bike? And because I knew it was going to be tough once I got back on a dirt bike, like, you know, being careful with my foot, not dabbing it and stuff like that. So, yeah, just did all the training I could and the cardio I could, you know, without using my foot. And, once I got back on the bike, it was pretty easy to get back into it, but I had to be careful with my foot, obviously. So, it was just step by step. It was like a new task I had and a new goal. I could focus on new things when, you know, certain things were behind me.
Awesome. How, once you finally get through all that, how fun was that first day back on the bike? Like, just even gearing up to know, like, hey, we've gone through all this, and finally I'm at this point where, yeah, we're getting ready to start another challenge, but at least I'm here and I get to go do what I like the most.
Yeah, so the first day was actually, honestly terrible. It was it was a good feeling, but we ended up riding the sand track that day, and like, I couldn't bear the weight to like stand up and do a double. Like, that imp, like, G-force or whatever was like almost enough for me to like have my like foot give out on me. So it was super fun. I was just cruising around all day, but I just had to be really careful, because I could like barely get my foot into a boot at that time. Like, I was kind of rushing to get back on the bike. I was like 4 weeks out from the start of the series, so I was trying to get somewhat ready to be, you know, a championship contender, and had to get on the bike sooner than I really wanted to. So just had to be careful with the foot, and it wasn't too fun. It was fun and not fun at the same time for different reasons. The foot was obviously bugging me pretty bad, and sore after that. But yeah, I guess the feeling of riding again after that long was definitely something else. It was just, it was like freedom again.
Yeah. Dude, 6 weeks to go from like first laps to first podium of the season, that's dang impressive. Heck yeah, Dustin.
Yeah, it came back pretty good. I just had to be careful with my foot. I didn't want to dab it and make it worse. Mm-hmm. And I did dab it. I remember one time my foot, I guess my toes were pointing out a little bit, and it caught a rut, and it made it back in the middle of a moto, and I just totally stopped and sat there for like 5 minutes to get my breath back. Mm-hmm. Like, I was like, oh man, did I hurt it? And I was like stressing out for a second, but I was just pretty sore for the next few days, but it was probably good for it.
You got to get that first one out of the way, yeah, so you know.
Exactly. Yeah.
Did you, from that to then what you went into through the summer is huge, and I really want to talk about the progress that you made, you know, with yourself and the bike, and so we'll get into that when we come back with this commercial break on the SML Show.
I'm Aaron Fletcher.
I'm Christian Craig.
I'm Hunter Lawrence.
Josh Mode.
I'm Cameron McAdoo.
I'm Justin Brayton.
Hey, I'm Lavin Muskan.
I'm Malcolm Stewart.
I'm Jiren Ferrangis.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
Welcome back to this episode of the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha. All right, Justin. So from that first race until now, I have to say I was very impressed with the way that you took on this summer. Talked to you quite a bit in those How Was Your Weekend interviews, talked to Mohead a lot, talked to Jensen over at the Star Team, and just to see where the outlook was to get you to where you needed to be this year was impressive. But I really like the way that you reinvented yourself and your riding style on the motorcycle, because not only did you already have one challenge on your plate, you decided to take on a few more because you knew now's the time that I have to do it. So to prepare yourself for this summer, what were your goals and what were the initiatives?
Honestly, coming into the summer, I wanted to be a championship contender. And, you know, the first half of the season, even after the first race, I was like, you know what, this is probably not going to happen. I already set myself pretty far back. I wasn't even top 10 in points after the first round. So it kind of shifted my mindset a little bit. I didn't really want to lose sight of that, but I just wanted to get back up front after the first race. That was kind of the goal from there. And obviously Jet was really consistent, and he won pretty much every weekend. So it was pretty clear that it was going to be hard to make up the distance that he had already gained. And I just started switching to, you know, going out and improving each weekend and, you know, trying to get up front and win motos and stuff like that. So pretty much from the beginning, it was just making myself better and the bike better. And we made a lot of progress throughout the year, and I think that showed towards the end.
Where were the bike changes? Like, where did that stem from? Was that, you and I have talked and you said you wanted to change your riding style and the way that you where riding wasn't really flowing with that. So was this a push from you, or was this people from the outside? Like, hey, if we tried these different things, it might get you where you need to be.
Yeah, well, last year I wasn't completely, you know, sold on my bike. I felt like it was really good, but I didn't really try anything else. Like, mm-hmm. I was stuck there, and I had to be. I didn't want to do anything to, you know, set me off, and you know, I was in a championship battle, so. We stayed there the whole year, and it worked great, but I felt like it could be better, so we went ahead and started making some changes to where I thought I could be better. And you know, after the first round, I think we were on the last year setting, so it was kind of a wake-up call. We're like, yeah, we might as well try something now. If I was that uncomfortable on the bike, and mm-hmm. probably had something to do with my foot, like not riding it 100% yet, but I know towards the end of the season, like looking back on the first round, I was nowhere near 100%. Like, mm-hmm. even though you might feel like you're going as fast as you can and you're doing everything that you can, just the time, like the consistent time on the bike, you just get that feeling with the bike that you can't replace with, you know, just 2 weeks on the bike, 3 weeks on the bike. You just get that feeling, and you know, with all that practice, you just gain trust with your motorcycle. You know it more, and you're able to do things a little bit better. So that's what I figured out. And we obviously made a lot of bike changes. Just a lot of testing, really, trying to make the bike better and more comfortable on the national tracks, because it's obviously different than, you know, just practicing at your home track and where it doesn't get as rough. So yeah, just a lot of playing around with things, trying to make things better and, you know, trying to just improve each weekend.
Mohead told me that you did a moto with like stock setup wheels and came back, and you had told, like, I think it was Nate Thrasher, like, hey, you have to go try this. And he didn't think it was going to be as big of a deal. And then he went out there and did it. But for you, this is really the first time that you're testing a bunch of stuff that wasn't a base setting that the team had given you. And I think that's huge, because now you're learning a lot about the bikes and learning a lot about the testing process as you go to the next steps of your career. Probably the first time, aside from like, hey, we're going to try some clickers here or there, that you've had big part changes, huh?
Yeah, it was a year of learning for sure. Like, I didn't wander too much last year, so when you do test, you get to learn more about the bike, and you can adapt to what's wrong. Mm-hmm. So that's important, and learning the bike yeah, really important, because you need to have that feedback on the days that you are struggling at the races. You need to know what to say. And if you can't communicate that to your team, then it's kind of like you're guessing at that point. Like, hey guys, what do I do? Like, it's really important to learn your bike, and that's something I've really not done a good job at. When I was a rookie, I didn't really even pay attention to that stuff. I just let the team like kind of watch me and, you know, do what they thought, and it worked good for sure, but it's left me now with a lot of learning to do when I do nitpick stuff. So that's probably the biggest challenge, and I'm getting better at that slowly.
I think it's cool though. I mean, it's right on time. You need to get those first few years out of your way to learn the thing, and then take the next challenge, and then the next challenge after that. When you would go to the races and you guys knew we're still setting up something with the bike, did it change the expectation for the weekend, or did it change your outlook? Because not only do you have to race as fast as you can, but you also have a couple other things you're trying to keep an outlook or a hold of.
Yeah, well, usually the stuff that we've tested during the week, we, you know, some stuff would be bad. We'd be like, no, we're not going to run that. There's no point. And we'd find a good setting, and we're like, all right, yeah, I think we should try this. And the outlook it gives you is like, all right, I got something better than I had last weekend. Like, we should be able to do better. And that, it kind of gives you, I guess you could say, a false confidence. Like, it hasn't been proven yet, but you're going to the race knowing that, hey, this might be better than last weekend, and hey, I might be able to go faster. So that was kind of the way I was feeling for, I don't know, round 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Like, I felt like we found something better each of those rounds. And it was fun to go to the race knowing that, yeah, I'm probably going to be better this weekend. I'm probably going to be more comfortable. And, you know, we were figuring stuff out with the bike, and I was figuring stuff out with myself. So each weekend was, definitely coming in confident and, you know, ready to go give it my best shot.
When do you feel like everything lined up and then your summer switched to what it was the rest of the year? Like, was there a race that you feel like, hey, this is where everything goes off after that?
I could easily say it was Washougal, but that second moto win, like my first moto win of the season, was, I felt like it was easier than, you know, that first moto at Washougal, I got fourth, and those guys kind of just walked away from me, and I felt like I was trying pretty hard, and yeah, the second moto, I felt like it came so easy. It's kind of weird. We made a few changes, like little changes in between the motos, but yeah, something just clicked that moto, and you know, once you win like that, it's everything kind of comes back, and you want to be that guy every moto, so. It was definitely like a confidence booster. I wouldn't say it was like a turning point. Like, I felt like I was riding good before that. Just never got really the opportunity. I remember a lot of weekends I was going down the first lap, or something was happening in the first lap, and that kind of just, you know, no one really sees that. So the results don't show anything there. But yeah, I think Washougal was definitely good for me, but I wouldn't say it was a turning point. I felt like I was gaining, just gaining momentum throughout around like 4, 5, 6. Just nothing was clicking, and I was like, I just need one weekend where I get out front, and you know, nothing happens. Like, I remember throwing away a couple motos out front, like the first couple laps with some water down or something like that, but just never got the chance to have, you know, a good weekend, a good solid weekend, and it was obviously clicking there at Washougal and Unadilla.
Okay, so then to those two motos, how important was Motocross the Nation's selection at that point in time? Was that the huge carrot dangling in front of you?
It was like it was more like me, like, hey, I need to win something.
Okay.
Like,
okay,
it's been a rough year, like up until that point, and yeah, I'm still pretty bummed about Unadilla. When I fell there, I was feeling really good that day, and obviously that's the hometown race for me, so I really wanted to win that overall, and yeah, I couldn't do that with a fifth in the first moto, but it was, at the time, it was a big deal for Motocross of Nations as far as the pick, who was going to get picked, and yeah, that did help because I felt like I should have been part of that conversation, you know, a little bit sooner. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't. So if anything, it kind of just it made me a little bit frustrated that people weren't seeing any potential in me, really. And yeah, everything was clicking those weekends, and that was definitely helping the cause, but I definitely wanted to prove it for myself that I still had it in me to go out and win. And it was really getting, like, I was really itching to win at that point. Like, mm-hmm. it was getting frustrating, and weekend after weekend being disappointed, you show up to the races mad. So it was definitely, relieving to get some moto wins for sure.
Yeah. So, I mean, to even the Sunday, Monday after Unadilla, this just goes to show the highs and lows of the summer. Then you get sick after that. Buds Creek is questionable, but then Buds Creek, you get announced to the team. So just the ebbs and flows of the year, you come in, you know, not where you need to be, get better, a couple setbacks here and there. But dude, I mean, to see everything how it was and for you to take that on, even to get the COVID thing, you know, and has that set off the last part of the year. Really good way to take on all these challenges this year. It's cool.
Yeah, I mean, after Unadilla, I got sick that night, and I didn't leave.
Oh, that night you did?
Yeah, so like, I raced Unadilla, went back to the hotel, and was like, oh man, like, I don't feel good. Like, I had the chills and everything in bed. I remember waking up, like, for the airport, and wasn't feeling good, and just had, just like, the energy was zapped out of me. Like, mm-hmm. obviously, it's bad after a race day. But it was just like, felt like a little bit unnormal. And I got tested and was positive. So I didn't leave the house. We got home Sunday. I didn't leave the house until Friday. Like, legit didn't leave the house once. And ended up feeling better Friday. When we went to the race, it was just nothing there. It was so, like, my body was so flat, and I ended up going down there first lap two, the first moto. So I came from the back and I don't know, somewhere in the top 10. But the second moto, I got the whole shot and I just had nothing left, I remember. And I fought for as long as I could, but I was going backwards quick. And it was weird because I felt really good until I got like on the track. And like I had, like, my breathing was off and mm-hmm. stuff like that. I think the COVID really messes with your respiratory system. Mm-hmm. Is what I've heard. And that was the hardest part to push through, really. Like, you couldn't tell unless you were on the track how you were feeling. So like any other day when I'm just, doing a bike ride or stuff like that, it kind of felt good. And then I get into like the high intensity stuff on the dirt bike, and man, I was just gasping for air, I felt like, the whole time, and I couldn't get a deep breath in. So, that kind of put a hinder to the end of the season. But, I was able to bounce back this weekend with another podium. It was obviously a hot one, so it put everyone to the test. And, did the best I could, fought through it.
Dude, it is so crazy. I mean, I go to 12 races, I go to everything. I see you guys every weekend. And I think I have an idea of what's going on, but then to know, like, well, there's this and this that happens behind that, and this guy's coming in to feel that way. And then you guys still line up and do it. Like, it is wild how much 40 dudes in each class are going through and how much you have to think about. So, like, thank you for explaining that to people that don't understand. They're like, oh, no, why is he doing this? It's like, no, dude, there's 20 other things in the background that explain these things right now.
Yeah, and it's tough to kind of explain that to everyone because you don't want to sell yourself short, and you don't want to make excuses. It's you want to do the best you can, and it's frustrating because at the end of the day, when you do have something wrong, it's, you kind of try to hide it because you have 40 other guys that, you know, want your spot. Mm-hmm. Like, whether that be on the podium or winning the day. So you try to keep it to yourself, to the people that are close around you, and sometimes that kind of people don't see what's really going on. So could probably be better about, explaining that kind of stuff. But again, you're in a situation where you want to do the best you can. And you don't want to show any weakness.
Dude, totally. I get it. Yeah. All right. We got one more commercial break and we'll come back with more with Justin Cooper.
We'll be right back.
All right, guys, Michael Antonovich here with Justin Cooper to wrap up this episode of the SML Show. So, Justin, as we go into this last part of 2022 and then look forward to 2023, a lot of big things on the horizon. First up, Motocross the Nations coming up at the end of September for you. Back on Team USA, which is a big deal. I was at Assen in 19, and you rode incredibly well considering the circumstances, the crashes, the hand injury. How important is it for you to be back on Team USA and just to have that honor?
Yeah, it's kind of like I've been waiting to do it. We obviously haven't been able to do it due to the COVID the last few years. And yeah, it's good to be back, especially in the USA. That's special for everyone. And yeah, Redbud's one of the greatest tracks. So it's obviously something I want to do and be a part of. And yeah, I just want to give it my all. I feel like I still have a few weeks, so a lot of time to, you know, prepare for it still, and I'm going to train hard going into it, and, you know, definitely leave it all out on the track there. So a little bit of a redemption, hopefully, from 2019, where, yeah, things didn't go so well. So, yeah, hopefully we can turn that around and bring this trophy home.
Seeing how this team has come together, seeing the championship that Chase and Eli just wrapped up, but then as soon as they got done on Saturday, as gnarly as that was, the expectation then turned to Motocross the Nation. So I think you even know too, like, oh wow, it's time. Everybody's gotta be as serious as possible, and you wanna do your part too.
Yeah, it's a big deal. I think everyone's aware of that, and everyone's been told that. Mm-hmm. It's no secret. Yeah, we have a good team this year, and it's gonna be exciting. I think we're gonna have some good days to get ready for this, and even riding the track. So yeah, we're putting it all into it again, and just like we did in 2019, and yeah, we're looking for big things to come out of it.
This will be kind of like your last race for a while. We know Supercross, you're not going to be able to ride the 250 due to eligibility rules. I'll be honest, I'm surprised that they didn't make like a rule change for you to defend, because you didn't even get the chance last year, but you know, that's another story for another time. So then how important is it for you to go out with a good result so people don't forget about you in that downtime? Because yeah, you might line up for something here and there until you get to 250 outdoors next year, but it's going to be a long winter.
Yeah, we'll see what happens. Nothing set in stone for the Supercross season. So yeah, as far as right now, we're looking forward to donations and then 250 motocross next year, but I'm sure something will fall into place over the time of Supercross, whether that be Supercross or, you know, any other racing. I'm sure I'll be doing something. I'll just be sitting around, but yeah, it's important to bring the trophy back to, mm-hmm. to the USA. It's been, I don't know, 6-7 years probably, maybe even 10. I think it's been around 10 years. And I feel like that's pretty long for mm-hmm. a country that's brought it home the most. And yeah, I think it's important to just all give it our best shot. We have a really good team, strong team this year. Obviously, Chase and Eli were going head to head for the 450 title, and you know, they're both riding really amazing. So definitely, I think everyone's gonna put their all into it. I think everyone's really excited to be on the team and to be a part of this. So I think we're gonna give it everything, and we're gonna have a really good shot, and it's exciting for sure.
What was the first year, like as a kid, that you recognized the Motocross the Nations? Like I can think of 2000, like Pastrana, Rhino, Ricky riding in France, and then 01, because of everything that was gonna happen and then didn't happen. So those two races like are really what solidified that event in my life. For you though, it's gotta be different because there's an age difference between us. What was the first one that you saw like, I have to do that one day?
Yeah, see, I didn't even know about the 01, like that didn't happen. Mm-hmm. Like I heard that only when we didn't do it in 2020 or whatever it was. But the first one I remember is, I actually went to it. It was Buds Creek 07.
Oh, really?
I think it was 07. And when Villopoto mm-hmm. went and dominated, and it was Carmichael's last ride or whatever. Looking back on it, it's like crazy to know that I was there. And I didn't like, kind of like, I was so young, I didn't realize how big that race was. Like, it was Carmichael's last ride, and like what Villopoto did that uh-huh. day, like obviously it wasn't registering like in my mind. I didn't know enough about it. But yeah, that was the first time I was a part of that. And yeah, that was the first time I was at that race and I knew about the Motocross of Nations. Okay. Before that, I didn't even know that was a race.
That's a good one to go to then.
Yeah, for sure.
How old were you?
Let's see, 2000, was it 2007?
Seven, yeah.
So I was like 10, 9,
okay.
10.
Okay. Old enough, I was like, if he's 5 at this thing, I'm gonna be like, oh my gosh. No, that's rad. That's the perfect age to remember. Yeah. I think it's so cool, you know, even when we went over a 19 and the effort that you guys put into it and the effort that's getting put in now, you guys know this is not some like, yeah, we're just gonna show up, take a gear bag, and it's that. There's a lot of effort and commitment and time that goes into this thing, and the level that you guys have to be at and what you're expected to be at. Like, no one cuts you any slack on this one.
Yeah, no, it's a team effort, and you don't really, at the other races, you know, you go out and do the best that you can for yourself, but here, your results are, the other guys are depending on your results, so it's, you want to bring your A game to this one, and you don't want to, you know, let anyone down, so it's important to bring everything you got, and it adds that little bit of, you know, hunger and pressure to want to perform, and especially for your country. So it's a unique race, and definitely glad to be a part of it again. And yeah, just ready to prepare the best I can and, you know, leave everything out there on the track.
Okay. As we wrap this up, I have two questions for you, completely separate from Motocross Nations. A couple months ago before Fox Raceway won, we had Nick Romano in the seat, and I was asking him what it's like to be a guy from like the New England or New York tri-state area to be a moto guy, because like, there's this nice little group of you dudes coming from there, and it's the most unusual place I would think of, because what tracks are there? So how is it that so many fast dudes are coming from there right now? Like, it's totally having its moment.
You know, I don't know. I could tell you I knew, like, if you're talking about Connecticut, upstate New York, there might be a little bit more freedom up there and like land, mm-hmm. riding and stuff like that. But the way that me and Nick came from Long Island area, like
nuts, dude.
New York City area, mm-hmm. like, yeah, nuts. Like, we didn't ride during the winter, and just honestly, I can't even answer the question for you. Like, I don't know how it happened and how everything came together like that. But for us to be where we are now is pretty special, and you know, really something to look at, because we, at least I didn't have you know, all the training facilities and stuff like that to go to. I didn't really have that freedom. I was in public school, so the way it came together is pretty special, and you know, something I always look back on. I'm like, whoa, like, how did this even all come together for me? Like, it seemed so far away at when I was an amateur, and for me to be sitting here now where I am is yeah, it's kind of mind-blowing for me, honestly.
I remember I went to New York when I was like 13, and I just remember seeing how condensed everything was, and like, you couldn't go through tunnels and this and this. I'm like, how could you even take a motorcycle anywhere? So to see you guys come from that, I'm like completely mind-blown, because it is so far removed from all these other people that grew up on property or down south or out here, you know, to see that you, Nick, Brandon, Tom Drenette, when his mom's around, to see all you guys come up together and have this great success right now has been cool this last like 3-4 years.
Yeah, it's like you had to get off the island in order to ride. There was only like maybe like a sand pit and one other track you could ride at. So that's pretty much what we did. And you know, we would go off the island to go to like Englishtown or something mm-hmm. like that. That was one of the good tracks. And my last year at A, they had like an open practice there every Wednesday, and I would go there from like, you know, when they started to dark. Mm-hmm. And that was like my prep, because it would get super, super rough, and you'd have like 20-minute sessions. So I'd just go out there and do as many as I could. And that's pretty much what I remember. Like, I didn't really get off the island too much. Maybe take a trip down south, like on a weekend, and if I could, and you know, ride a couple days. But as far as that, we just did some like arena cross during the winter, and other than that, it was sit on the couch, play in the snow, you know, that kind of stuff, go to school during the winter. So it was pretty cool to be here now, for sure.
I have a million questions about what it would be like to grow up in New York, but we don't have a lot of time for that. Yeah. So instead, we'll wrap this up. Is there anybody you want to shout out after this year and as we go on to the next thing?
I mean, just been with Star for 5 years now, so they've been behind me, and yeah, don't really see an end with them too near. So just, yeah, we'll keep plugging away.
Cool. Well, hey, thanks for coming by today, bud.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Thanks to you guys for watching this episode of the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha. I'm Michael Antonovich. Thanks for watching. As always, be sure to like and subscribe to our channel and follow us on social media. Talk to you guys soon.